So.
And sorry, Cindy, do we have all participants through the WebEx? Everybody's been let in?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Good morning and aloha, everyone. It's 9:04 a.m., February 25th, 2022. And this is the meeting of the HART Board of Directors. As far as I know, no members are physically present in the HART building, well, the HART room, and everyone else is participating remote. I have to make some procedural announcements. As you all know, this meeting is being held via video conferencing to Governor Ige's emergency proclamation related to COVID-19 Omicron variant dated January 26, 2022, and Mayor Rick Blangiardi's proclamation and emergency order 2021-1 COVID-19 novel coronavirus of January 5, 2022. In order to allow public participation in a manner consistent with social distancing practices. I have some procedural announcement. Members of the public will be allowed into the meeting room if they so wanna do so. Then you of course may view this meeting via live broadcast as described in the agenda. And though some may have registered to testify remotely, we of course will be announcing for anyone who wants to testify, as we've done in the past, we've always done that, and remote testimony will be accepted on all items or testimony of anyone who wishes to participate. So then we will of course have the staff call names, and at the end I will ask for anyone who wishes to join who may not have registered, which is not a requirement. We do note that there may be a slight delay, so please monitor your screen. Check the join in button and make sure that your audio feed when you are called upon is on. We do ask that before you testify, each person state their full name and which agenda item they wish to testify on. And of course you can testify on all agenda items or any specific ones. That way the members of the board can be in tune to where you are going to testify. They are limited to a 1 minute presentation on all items. So for those of you who are watching the proceeding on Olelo, please mute your television at the time that you're called to testify. And when the timer goes off, please conclude your remarks as promptly as you can. With those who are joining us by telephone only, I may not have your name, so you have to identify yourself by the last three digits on the telephone number when it comes on the screen. There may be a slight delay again, and make sure you press 0.6 to unmute yourself when you're prompted. And when all testifiers have testified, I will close the remote testimony. All governor's proclamation requires all votes at remote meetings to be conducted by roll call unless unanimous. Therefore, I will first call for the objections or reservations if there are any. And if not, I will assume that we have a unanimous vote. Written testimonies, including the testifier's address, email address, and phone numbers will be available to the public as described on the posted agenda. And as a courtesy, please turn off your cell phones during this meeting, and that goes to members as well. So let us now begin with the agenda before us. I will begin first by calling the roll. So when I call your name, please indicate that you're here. Anthony Alto.
Present.
Michelle Chun Bromgrabber. Is Michelle here?
She's not present, Chair.
Okay. Kika Bukowski.
Present.
Jade Butai.
Present.
Joffrey Kudilma.
He is not present.
Mark Howland.
Present.
Natalie Iwasa.
Here.
Lynn McCrory. No Lynn yet.
She is not present.
Roger Morton.
Here.
Joseph O'Donnell is excused. Dean Ochida.
Here.
Okay. Members, we have quorum, so we will proceed with the rest of the agenda. We will first begin with the public testimony on all agenda items. Do we have anyone who has asked to testify on a specific agenda item, or anyone who is calling in to testify on any agenda item? Cindy?
Chair, we don't have anyone registered and we don't have anyone logged on wishing to testify, it appears.
So if anyone is deciding to testify, and as we stated earlier, not required to actually register, can you please indicate to us by calling into the number or some way, if you're a participant, you know, put your hand up symbolically that you wish to testify. Anyone, any indications that did we have anyone? Cindy?
We do not, Chair.
Okay. So we will proceed with the various items on the agenda. So the first item is item number 3, committee appointments by the chair. As you know, under the rules of the Hart Ward, the chair has the discretion to decide who will be not only the chair of the subcommittees, but who will also be members of the subcommittee. So I'm going to go over these, even if some of them have not changed. So government affairs, audit, legal matters. Anthony Alto was kind enough to be our chair. Lynn McCrory is the vice chair. Staffing that committee is Jade Butai, Roger Morton, and Mark Howland. Finance, how we want to explain this, but with the departure, is a nice way of putting it, of our friend Dean Hazama. Kika Bukowski has agreed to be the finance chair. Jay Butai is the vice chair. I am removing myself off of the finance committee. Roger Morton remains. And we are going to have an appointment very shortly from the mayor, of the mayor's appointee. And the mayor's appointee is right now slotted for that position. But once he gets confirmed, gets announced, we will announce again. Project oversight. I believe project oversight is a very critical committee. And I know we've had interests stated by certain members of our board who would like to sit on project oversight. And because of the recovery plan and everything else that we must have to deal with, I believe that this committee should be equivalent to a committee of the whole. In other words, every voting member will sit on the project oversight committee. And I will continue to chair it as I do the board and have all members. Kika Bukowski remains as the vice chair, but all voting members are members of the project oversight committee. What I do wish to inform everyone is that it also means that I'm going to have challenges with quorum, possibly. But as all of you know, we've had everyone participating in project oversight anyway. So I think that this is a good way to get all the board members involved and all the board members having a vote on project oversight. So that's the major change in project oversight. Mark Howland, I know, specifically requested it. So Mark, you are a member of project oversight. Human resources, Lynn McCrory is the chair. We did not have a vice chair. So the mayor's appointee will be that vice chair. And the other members will remain as Kika, Roger Morton, and Anthony Alto. Internal audit, Lynn McCrory is also the chair of that, and Mark Howland I believe we had identified you earlier as the vice chair, and we will continue to do that. Kika Bukowski and the mayor's appointee, when he is appointed, will be on that committee. Executive Matters Committee, as you know, has a special role in our, under our rules. It is by rule, I am the chair. I have Anthony Alto as the vice chair. And then we also have Puka in our structure, which is the board vice chair position, which was Jeannie Hazama. So I would like to just notify the members that at the next meeting, you will be asked to vote on a vice chair. And in the meantime, I would appreciate it if you would either volunteer or nominate members so that we can have this determination by the board, who would be the board vice chair. The board vice chair also sits on the Executive Matters Committee. Jade Butai is on that committee, as is Kika Bukowski on that committee as well. So that is the lineup of the committee membership. As you know, it's discretionary, but if any of you have any heartburn on it, please email Cindy, who will get it to me. And you know, it's always subject to the chair's determination. I also would like to say this, is that because we're talking about the structure of the committees as well as the structure of the board and the board's the chair's authority, that I intend to comply with the rules of the board, and the rules require that we have an annual election of the board chair as well as the board vice chair. So that will take place in June. So people who would like to serve, or people who would like to nominate someone, please keep that in mind, but that will also be coming up, and that will also affect the composition of the committee membership, because I expect that the committee membership that we're making now, including the chairmanship plus the vice chairman of the board, will all potentially change in the June meeting to be effective July 1. So please keep that in mind. And with that, I will move on to the next item. Item number 4, which is the Executive Director and CEO's update. And that is Laurie. Is Laurie here?
Yes, I'm here, Chair.
Okay, so Laurie, why don't you take it? I don't know how you want to handle this, but just for the members of the public who may not be looking at the agenda, you have 4 agenda items: City Center Utilities Relocation 3 contract, General Engineering Consultant 4 contract, Risk Refresh of the Project Management Oversight Contractor, and Double Crossover Frog Type Gauge. Now, you want to take them in order, and you can just read off which one you're talking
yes.
about.
Yes, Chair, I'll do that. Okay, thank you. So for the first agenda item, City Center Utility Relocation Contract, it has been awarded to Frank V. Coluccio. We have already been in contact with them, and the notice to proceed will probably be in the June timeframe. The next agenda item, actually there's two, the General Engineering Consultant 4 contract and our CENI contract have both been awarded. NTP for the GEC contract is slated for April, and I just found out this morning for our CENI, it will be executed next week, and this was to fulfill our commitment to you, the board. You folks approved an amendment to extend 6 months, but we wanted to beat that, and we did. So, and then agenda item C, risk refresh by the project management oversight consultant. They are coming here, they're physically flying here, and will be on site March 28th for 1 week, and this actually sets our EAC, estimate at completion, and schedule, because this is what they're going to be the ones, PMOC is going to be the one to recommend to FTA. So this is very critical portion of our recovery plan. So they'll be here the March 28th week. The last agenda item I'd like to take some time with, this is the double crossover what we refer to as the frog, the tight gauge issue. So yes, thank you, Cindy, for sharing this. This is what I'm talking about when I say tight gauge. So the running rails, the ones that are parallel to each other in the straightaway, this is what we refer to as a gauge. Now, when the initial wheel rail interface came about, when we discovered that issue, we hired TTCI. They are the industry experts, and their phase one work was to do an analysis under normal conditions. The second phase work was to do 36 different scenarios on wear of the tracks and the wheels. So when they started their analysis in the November timeframe, they discovered that there's data for the main line, the straightaway, but not the double crossovers, those frogs. So they asked Hitachi to run their geometry cart to obtain the data, the necessary data for them to do their analysis over the frogs. This was done in the December timeframe. And TTCI noticed some anomalies. So we asked our consultant, our core systems consultant, Leon Elliott, to obtain the dimensions manually. Instead of running the geometry cart, they manually went out there and took measurements every foot on the double crossovers. And they did confirm the anomalies that the geometry cart found. So TTCI was, once they received the data, they did their analysis and they found out in mid-January that there's an issue here. This is what we're referring to as a tight gauge. And when I refer to gauge, right guys, like you can see in this photograph, it's the running rails, the distance between the running rails. Tolerances that I'm referring to is extremely thin, very slim. So the tolerances have to be within 3/32. So that is slightly less than 1/8 inch. So these tracks, which were installed back in 2015, the tracks are too, that gauge is too tight. And the tracks that are affected, so it's not the entire west side, it's the 50 feet feeding into the frogs. Cindy, if you could go to the next graphic, please. So it's affecting five double crossovers on the first segment. It includes East Kapolei, Honouliuli, West Lock, Leeward Community College, and Pearl Ridge. So on this graphic, the red lines are the tracks. This is when, if the trains are running in the west direction or if they're running in the east direction. Those X's, Cindy, I don't know if you can point with your pointer. The X's, the red X's, yeah, there you go. The red X's are where those double crossovers are. Now, these double crossovers will only be used on rare occasions when there's a problem with one of the tracks and we need to divert the train onto the other track. Normal straightaway, the tight gauge does not, there's not an effect. It's not causing any issues. It's only when Hitachi will have to go over the double crossovers to change tracks. So in the spirit of being open, honest, and transparent, I don't have all of the answers. But as soon as we found out about this, I just wanted to share with you, board, and the public. We just shared with our PMLC project management oversight consultant, who's contracted by FTA. We just shared it with them this week. We are still trying to determine the root cause of this issue. We are still trying to determine the appropriate solution to address this tight gauge issue. Right now, we meet every day. We meet with the internal team, which includes Hart, Leon Elliott, TTCI, Hitachi, HDOT, DTS, get all of the appropriate subject matter experts in the room and to work through this problem. And so some thoughts that have been discussed as far as solutions, it can be as simple as Cindy, if you could go back to the previous graphic, please. It's as simple as unbolting them, doing the slight adjustment of 330 seconds, and then rebolting them. That will be done. It's very quick. It can be done in the same time frame as the welding that needs to be done. We're also looking at maybe when the double crossovers have to be used, slow down, put a speed restriction instead of 20 miles per hour, go down to 10 miles per hour. Or there's another solution being discussed is we actually have to cut the rails, re-weld them, and then we have to retest. This all needs to be done before we can go into trial running. So I apologize, board. The critical questions that I don't have answers to is the root cause of this issue and what is the solution and how long is it going to take to implement the solutions. We did fly in our track expert 2 weeks earlier. He was supposed to be here for the welding work that is to commence within the next couple of weeks. We expedited his travel here. He's going to do an analysis on 5 of the double crossovers. He should be done within the next couple of weeks and working hand in hand with TTCI and to give the extent of how bad the situation is. And I just want to also make clear that this is completely separate from the original wheel rail interface issue. The welding fix that has been determined, as I mentioned, the welders are going to be here on island this weekend. They're going to go through the mandatory training that Hitachi has imposed next week, and then the actual welding should commence shortly after that. I know this was a lot to take in, so I'm open to questions. It's still very fresh. We don't have all of the answers. We don't have all of the details yet, but this is as much as I know at this point.
Laurie, are you done with your presentation?
Yes, Chair.
Thank you. So members, I know that this, especially this double crossover is a surprise, and it is separate and different from what we've been talking about, the welding and, you know, whether or not we, the wheels and so forth and so on. So open to questions, any member, please either raise your hand or just shout out your name. I don't have everyone's face on my screen. So anyone has any questions, Laurie? Yes, Anthony, I see Anthony's hand.
Yeah, so I was just wondering, what is the danger of this new situation? In other words, could it risk a derailment, or is it going to cause damage to the equipment? What is the specific concern? That's one question. And the second one is, trains have been running as doing test runs up and down the line for a long time. I'm wondering, you know, have they been impacted by this, and what are the impacts?
Okay, so yes, thank you, Anthony, for those two questions. So the possible impact, I think, worst case scenario, there could be a derailment. But like I said, we're talking such tight tolerances, and to your point, we've been running the trains and there hasn't been an issue, but just in, you know, to be as safe as we possibly can, that's why when we noticed what this tight tolerance issue came up, we have all of the safety people too in our discussions to make sure that this train is going to be the safest possible for our riders. The other extent, yes, but normal wear and tear is expected on the tracks and the wheels. This is why we had TTCI run their 36 scenarios on the impact on this. And so we don't have all of the answers yet to your question is what is the long-term effect? So we're still going through that.
Anyone else? Questions?
Chair, Jay?
Yes, Jay.
Lori, you know, we have our own quality assurance staff. Shouldn't they have verified this issue instead of DCCI? I mean, the track has been installed for years, so how is it possible that we didn't know this was not in tolerance?
Yes, that's the same questions we're asking, Jade. As I mentioned, it was installed in 2015. We don't know the root cause of this. It could be all the way back from the design to the manufacturer, to the installation, and as you mentioned, our own inspection, QA, QC, O&M. So we don't have the root cause right now. Right now, the main focus is, what is the extent of the issue? How can we fix it in the most safe and expeditious manner? And then after that, we are still looking at what caused this? Why wasn't this found sooner? So very good questions that we're asking the same thing.
Jade, any follow-up?
I mean, how much of a delay, I guess, will this cause?
Correct. So if it's the simple solutions that I mentioned earlier, that's only three that I'm sharing right now, but the team is still analyzing the extent of the issue and what are some of the possible solutions. I mean, all different ideas are being thrown out, but if it's simple enough that we can just unbolt them, slide them over slightly, you're talking weeks, 2 weeks, or the speed restriction. There's no delay over there, but the cutting, if we had to cut, I'm hearing it could delay several months because we would have to cut, re-weld, and retest. But right now, I don't have a good answer of how long of the delay is this.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Jade. Anyone else? Anyone else with questions?
Chair.
Yes, Kika?
Not any questions on the double crossovers, but on some of the earlier items you mentioned, Lori, on the GEC and CENI contracts, did you mention or can you mention who have those contracts?
Yes. So GEC, it's the same, Jacobs. And for CENI, it was Stantec.
Okay. And then on the risk refresh.
Yes.
You mentioned that there's a team coming in or in March 28 timeframe to assist on the risk refresh.
Yes.
Who is that coming in?
Okay. I don't have all of the team members, but it is the PMOC. So Mike and Danny. And they have different team members too.
Okay, so if that's the PMOC.
That's the PMOC.
Are they going to be part of this risk refresh? Are they going to discuss the P65 and the contingency? And is that part of it?
Yes, I believe so. But Nate Meddings is on this call. If I could ask him to elaborate.
Yes, absolutely. Kika, that's the intent. So it's actually the PMOC and FTA's risk refresh, and it's their team that's going to conduct it with the help from our team. We're going to work with them over the next several weeks to look at our base cost, base schedule, all of our cost forecasting, like our change management logs, give them a good basis. They're also sitting in on our value engineering workshop that's going to happen over the next 2 weeks. And then they come in, take all of that information and meet with the whole entire management team, identify risk, similar to what we did in our risk reset. Then they run that through their risk modeling, and whatever that spits out as the EAC and schedule is going to be what they recommend to the FTA to use in our recovery plan. So that will address your question on contingency. So their view of our risks is what is going to be the official amount of contingency on the project.
So what is the estimated time frame that you think we might get some final numbers?
So they recognize we had a really good breakout session yesterday with them on this topic. They recognize our tight time frame to complete the recovery plan. It's typically for them like a 4-week process to turn things around after the risk refresh. Our expectation is they get us a gut check in a week and then they deliver it within 2 weeks. So they're going to try to meet that time frame with us. That's why all this legwork at the beginning that we're going to do over the next month is really important.
So you're looking at possibly mid-April?
Mid-April at the earliest for them to finalize their report.
Thanks. I did have some questions regarding the double crossovers, but I mean, I hear Laurie, you know, it's they're still looking into it further. So I'll just hold until they have more info. Maybe they'll answer the questions that I have. So thanks, Chair.
I appreciate that, Kiko. Thank you.
And I can add a few things, Laurie. I mean, these double crossovers, I don't know that you mentioned it, but they're already designed for such slow speed. So, you know, the question was asked about what's the risk. Anthony, I think that was you. The design speed on these double crossovers are so slow. You know, I think they're 20 miles an hour, 10 miles an hour, and they're seldomly used. So only the ones at the end, like Lori said in that diagram. So the design speeds are lower, and obviously that lowers the risk. But what our experts are doing is they're going out and taking detailed measurements on every single DXO to try to come up with, are there consistencies in these anomalies of the measurements? They're also field fitting our spare double crossovers or DXOs in the yards. So we have ones that are sitting in the yard that they're assembling to get kind of the as manufactured tolerances as well and the measurements. And then they're going to go out and start adjusting these to see if they can just do the simple adjustments, get them into tolerances. Doing all those steps will allow us to verify, was it designed correctly? Was it manufactured correctly? Was it installed correctly? And, you know, based on all of that, is the maintenance frequency and requirements adequate for these things moving forward? So those are just a few different steps we have leading into what's the root cause and then the fix.
Nate or Laurie, are there potentially short-term changes and long-term permanent fixes that could be considered? This facility is going to be built for 100 years. We need to get it right for the long term as well.
Yes, thank you for that. I'll start and then Nate can jump on if I don't say enough. That's exactly what we're having the team look at, short term, mid term, and long term. Right. What are some things that we can do right now and make sure it's still safe and can operate? You know, DTS can operate this, but get this trial running going and get us into revenue service. But that's short term, but what is the long term fix? So we're looking at all of them. Nate, did I miss anything?
No, that's exactly right, Roger. We're very cognizant of the long term O&M costs and safety and just the resources from your guys' team that would be required and from the Hitachi side of things. As you know, that's why there's single crossovers and the spare doubles, because we always planned to replace these double crossovers at some frequency. So the system being set up like that allows for single track maneuvers while these things are being maintained or replaced. So the long-term solution would obviously be getting something in here that's new, that fits, you know, and have those be replaced earlier in the Hitachi's maintenance plan rather than later. So we're looking at both of those.
Okay, thank you, Nate.
What did you say, Roger? I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
I said thank you.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Chair.
Yes, Kika.
So I apologize. I got one quick question. So there's five affected double crossovers, but that's five out of how many? Is there more than five total?
Oh, for the entire system, I believe there's 13 all the way to Alamoana. There's 13 double crossovers, but right now, these five are the ones that are on segment one, and we are already starting to look at AGS sections. They've installed one. So we want to make sure whatever we're doing on the west side, lessons learned going forward on the AGS and city center. But this could potentially affect all of them.
Yeah. And then I guess my questions that I'll save for another time is more towards the long-term maintenance. If this might be a reoccurring issue or is it a permanent fix? So anyway, thank you.
Thank you, Kiko.
Anyone else?
Chair Anthony.
Yes, Anthony.
I'm wondering, I know it's very early days, you're scrambling to find out what went wrong. We're talking about nearly 7 years ago now, but do you have a ballpark or a range of what the costs might be to fix this problem?
We don't. For the simple solutions, you're just talking about time to unbolt, put it in, so it shouldn't cost more. It shouldn't cost very much. It's just the time for the staff to get out there and adjust them. If it's for the cutting, I have some preliminary numbers from my staff. The welding, to do the cutting and the welding, I want to say it was a couple of thousand per cut, per weld. So I don't have a full scope yet, Anthony, because we don't know the extent of the issue, what needs to be done on all five of them.
But at the moment, it doesn't sound like we're looking at a solution that might cost tens of millions.
Oh, no. Correct.
So it's very similar, if I may add, it's very similar to like the weld fix that we're exploring, that the actual fix is relatively quick and relatively cheap in the overall scheme of things. But the true cost is the impact to the revenue service schedule. And that's the true cost, but the cost to actually fix it is pretty quick. We're talking about maybe a weekend worth of work for each of these DXOs.
Anyone else? See anyone? I just want to clarify some things about this. First of all, you know, you mentioned that TTCI had two contracts, the phase one and the phase two. So I assume that TTCI is still engaged in the phase two, the 36 different alternatives. Is that correct?
Correct.
Yeah. So they are still under contract with HART.
Yes.
So if the, we're not going to have a problem like we did with Tri-Unity, whose contract was over. So if we were to ask them to appear before the next POC meeting, that should not be a difficulty on your part, right?
Correct, Chair.
Okay, so we will probably make that request. Okay. The next POC meeting, which is all the voting members of this board, and everyone, of course, attends. So we'll get a better sense. What I was interested in is, you know, when they went through this, were they the ones who discovered the problem in November or December? When was it? Or was there someone, another consultant or anyone else on the project that discovered it? I'm really interested in Hitachi's role as well. What does Hitachi do now that, you know, these are all installed and technically they're supposed to have at least a 5-year, maybe 10-year operations contract?
Correct. So yes, TTCI was the one to discover the issue, because when we were asking them to run the different scenarios, that's when they noticed that the data that was provided to them was only in the straightaway, nothing on the double crossovers. And to your point, Chair, same thing. We don't have the root cause yet. We don't know the responsibilities of the different entities, to include Hitachi. We just don't have enough information yet. Nate, can you elaborate any more on what I've shared?
I think a little bit. So TTCI, this was their phase two work that identified this. So their phase one work didn't identify it. This was identified in the phase two because it was to look at the long-term wear of that wheel rail interface. And to provide a little bit more detail, they looked at it, as Lori said, saw that the geometry carts that they run through these to get the data was only used to go through the straightaway positions. They said, well, we need these double crossover measurements too. So they sent out some of our core systems oversight team to measure these. They got the measurements back, ran them through the model, said, hey, we see some anomalies. Will you re-measure and confirm these measurements? went out there, did that. Once they got that confirmation, reran the model, they said, okay, we think there's something wrong. Let us come out there and check it out. And that's when we shipped out our track expert as well to verify those. And that was about 2 weeks ago. And we are where we are at today. And then he's got those few next steps that I talked about to complete the full picture for his model.
I guess one of the issues I have is that, you know, they kind of discovered this in November, and I think the first reporting of it we had was, I think, early December, and this is almost March, where, you know, if it's, and so the question is, you know, what did we do? What did, because they're still HART's consultants, so they are sort of like our agents, so they had this knowledge. So why are we learning about it now?
Well, let me reiterate the timing. So TTCI was told start phase two in November. And then that's when they determined, wait, I don't have all the data that I need. So in December, they asked Hitachi, run your geometry card over. And then they said, oh, you know, we noticed some anomalies. So after in December, in January, they had Lee and Elliot go out there to physically take the data. So in mid-January is when TTCI finished their analysis that, yes, confirming this is, there are anomalies. And so prior to that, they didn't know the extent. I mean, maybe there's not even an issue. So until they could confirm that, yes, this is an issue in mid-January, that's when we were notified, Rick and I were notified end of January, and we still didn't, we don't have all of the answers. And that's why I was a little bit hesitant to share with the board so soon, because I don't have everything, but I don't want to be like I'm trying to hide anything either. But I don't think we took that long to share with you folks, because TTCI themselves did not confirm until mid-January that there is an issue.
I guess we'll find out when TTCI comes before the board, because I remember a date of December 3rd. I don't know where I heard that, but December 3rd was the date when we had knowledge of it. So I think we'll find out when TTCI comes.
Sure.
The reason I'm concerned about that is because whatever fix you may decide on, which then, and then, you know, we have Roger, of course, on the call as well, which may or may not affect the long-term, which is one of the issues that was raised by Anthony. What is the long-term impact of this? So if we do or accept something expedient or something that we think is sufficient, but in the long-term may not be that. I think we owe an explanation, of course, to the people, but more, and as important as that, it's also who's gonna do the warranty on this? I mean, you know, it's something that you didn't discover until now, what the implications will be. So will then DTS be asked to sign off, HART be asked to sign off, Hitachi be asked to sign off, or whatever the remedy is gonna be? Because short of that, it seems like we'll be tossing over to the city, DTS, whatever we may decide is, you know, it may be great that we don't affect revenue service or so forth, but the question will be, what does it mean for this? The health and welfare and the safety of the people in the future.
Correct. So we are not making any of these decisions in a vacuum. As I mentioned, DTS, HDOT, they're all involved with the discussions every day. We meet every day at 4 o'clock with all of the subject matter experts. What is the best solution? And we're not gonna just dump something on DTS. I mean, I come from operations myself, and I would not do that to an operating department. So we need to make sure everyone is comfortable that whatever the solution is, it's safe, like you said, to the community, to our riders, and it's acceptable to DTS that we're not handing them over a nightmare, an O&M nightmare. It's not fair to them, and we wouldn't do that.
So you said HDOT, so Jade's department also has a say in this?
Yes, Brandon, because ultimately the safety falls under their jurisdiction.
So I'm sure Jade would be interested in also, yes, hearing the TTCI report that we will have. The other question I have is with the risk refresh. Nate, that's an awfully tight, basically all the way to the middle of April. We have to get something to, and I know that the idea is that you'll be working hand in hand with the FTA up until that point, but notwithstanding, we have to come up with the pig. We have, as you know, the board has its own pig that's doing the recovery plan, but you have to get this recovery plan not only to the board, but also to city council before it can actually go to FTA as the official act of the city or of HART. So given that scenario, what does it look like? What's the realistic time that we can anticipate a lot of these, an EAC, for example? We may not, and you know, it could be that we don't agree, that we may not agree with whatever the FTA may say. And so the city may come up with a different kind of recovery plan or may stress it a different way. So what then, what's the really the exact date that we might be able to, as a board, anticipate a recovery plan, but in addition to that, as a pig, getting all the information that we may need to assist in the pig report?
Okay, good question. So FTA and PMOC hold a lot of value in the tri-unity validation and the tri-unity validated cost and schedule. So we as a program are going to maintain their product, you know, and their contingency recommendations and base cost and schedule recommendations. So we are going into our value engineering workshop with the tri-unity validated numbers, because right now we have a peer review, a tri-unity validation that PMOC and FTA have a lot of confidence in. We're going into the value engineering workshop over the next 2 weeks to figure out how can we reduce scope, how can we build better, how can we build faster, more efficiently. What comes out of that value engineering workshop on March 11th is what we can actually afford to build based off these value engineering concepts. Then we take that final determination of scope and update the basis of cost, basis of schedule for that scope, hand it over to PMOC and FTA, who we've already been working with on our tri-unity validated basis of cost, basis of schedule. So they look at that, they have a good basis for it already. They have 2 weeks to get comfortable with that before it goes into their risk refresh. That risk refresh, hopefully we will get the results back in mid-April and we can finalize the recovery plan after that. We are gonna already be cranking through the recovery plan with the hope that there's no big surprises from the PMOC risk refresh, because we've been working with them so closely, like you said. Hopefully they perceive our risks, our base costs, the tri-unity validation of both of those. Hopefully they view those the same as we do, and there's no surprises coming out of that risk refresh. That's our best case scenario, that they say, all right, actually, HART, we agree with what you guys assessed. We're not going to recommend a different cost or schedule. Button it up. Let's march forward with the recovery plan.
What's the worst case scenario?
The worst case scenario would be that they reassess their risk refresh based off the risks that they see. And these aren't just project risks. These are political risks. These are risks of, you know, can we march forward through the recovery plan process? And they recommend, similar to what they did in the last recovery plan. If you guys remember, our operating recovery plan was 8.165, but we had to demonstrate financial recovery or capacity to 8.299. So in that case, they said, all right, Art, we don't agree with your risk refresh. We want our own risk refresh recommendation that was $130 million higher. So if they go that case, then they'll make us demonstrate financial capacity to their number.
I guess the question is, the next council meeting, which you need this recovery plan to be approved by is June 1st. So you're talking about possibly mid-April if everything goes right. Then you're going to have to come to us, and then it's going to have to go to council. And that's that I think is a very tight time frame that we're all dealing with. It's great that we hope that everything goes smoothly, but we also have to realize and what happens, for example, if the council or the board decides it doesn't agree with your recovery plan. And if the council doesn't agree with the recovery plan, then come June, ending of June, when this is due to the FDA, what then happens?
It's a tight time frame recognized by all parties. We had that same conversation with PMOC FTA yesterday. And their comments were, well, you need us to turn this around in 2 weeks. It usually takes us a month. And our response was, yes, we understand the tight time frame. And we actually turned around that same effort in a week, you know. So we're all operating on those tight time frames. That's just what we have to do in order to meet that FTA deadline. The only way that it's going to work is keeping everybody in the loop along the way. So marching forward with the main meat and potatoes or components of the recovery plan, sharing it with the FTA, PMOC, and you guys along the way, and council and everybody, so nobody's surprised with the end product. I don't see another way that we can make that work as a group.
In other words, June 30th is the real hard stop.
Yes.
Okay. So the public knows, the reason why the board created its pig was that so that the board would not be asked to vote on a recovery plan right before or right after is the last day that it could be voted on. And I'm pretty sure council probably feels the same way, though they have not formed the pig, is that this is too critical for the project. But I'm hoping that we will be able to continue the working relationship that we have, and we can get at least to the point where the board will have a good understanding and won't feel like it's being forced to basically rubber stamp something. So anyone else have any questions or follow-ups?
Chair, this is Natalie.
Yes, Natalie.
Thank you, Nate and Lori, for your presentation and answering our questions. Regarding the recovery plan, it seems to me the biggest component, or probably most significant, is the financial plan that's underlying it. So is that going to come out any sooner than the recovery plan that we'll be asked to review?
So I think the answer is, this recovery plan is different than the previous recovery plans. The previous recovery plans were very aggressive and how can we make it to Ala Moana, right? This recovery plan is what can we afford to build? And so in order to get that, Natalie, we need to figure out what we have as far as what we can afford to. So those numbers are one of the stepping stones to get the recovery plan. So, we got to identify, lock in that funding plan, but part of the overall financial plan is what is going to be the cost of the scope, so you can look at interest rates, et cetera. So we kind of need those two pieces, and that all comes out of the next few weeks in that value engineering session. And then I think out of the value engineering workshop gives us the scope. We can plug that into a financial model, look at what the total interest would be. That gives us a relatively close baseline, but then ultimately that PMOC risk refresh will be able to allow us to finalize the financial plan, because we will have to do that financial plan to their P65 or 55 output of their risk refresh, if that made sense.
Natalie, if I could add to, I'm sorry for my delay response. I was checking to make sure Rick was on the line because he's intimately involved with this, along with Dean Hazama and his team. But
hey, Lori, I'm on. So just to answer Natalie's question, the financial plan is
a section in the recovery plan itself. So you will be getting the whole thing as a package.
Yes. So, but there's different components into that, as Nate was saying. So Dean and Rick and their group, they're working on the revenue side, and our project controls group, we need to understand, and it ties to what Nate was saying with the value engineering, what the ultimate cost of the project is, and then it needs to be detailed enough to a month cost basis, because that goes into our financing costs. And so we're waiting for all of these pieces to get together before we can get the financial part of it together. But yes, we're hoping to not, as Chair has said, dump everything on you folks at one time, because you need time to review and process and give your comments. But as we're finishing the different sections, and Rick is the overall person to make sure that it's all gelling together, it all makes sense. We're incorporating, DTS gave us their section just this week. And as the pieces are coming together, we would like to share it with you folks as quickly as we can.
Okay, thank you, Laurie. Appreciate that, because as you know, one of my concerns is that the revenue projections are a little bit aggressive. You know, just based on the history, and I understand that GET is up over what was projected, but I'm still very concerned about it, and so appreciate every effort that you can make to get that information to us as soon as possible. Thank you.
Anything else, Natalie?
No, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Hearing none. Thank you. Thank you, Nate. Thank you, Laurie.
Chair, thank you, members.
So we will be moving to the next agenda item, which is resolution 2022-1, approving the settlement of the claim by the Associated Press. And for this, members, I am requesting a motion that the board enter into executive session pursuant to Hawaii Revised Statute Section 92-4, subsection 92-5A4. And this is, of course, to consult with our attorneys on questions and issues on the matters pertaining to the board's powers, duty, privileges, immunities, and liabilities. Can I have a motion to that effect? Anyone?
This is Roger. I'll move.
Thank you, Roger. Any second?
This is Jade, I second.
Thank you, Jade. Is there any objections to us going into executive session on this matter?
Chair, it's Natalie. Just a comment, please.
Yes, Natalie.
Thank you. So just for the record, I'd like to note that there is a discrepancy, a significant difference in point of view between the treatment of at the AG level and the City Corporation Council level, of the treatment of the state appointees who haven't signed the confidentiality agreement. And so I hope that that will be worked through soon, so that those who haven't signed that agreement can participate in the executive sessions. Thank you.
Thank you, Natalie. By the way, I have been, I'm under the impression that Joffrey will be signing the confidentiality, but thank you very much. And as you also probably know, Jade, who is the ex-official member of the board by way of the charter, but also a state employee, has also signed that confidentiality. But yes, I do hope that we do have a resolution on this. It's in the hands of the attorneys, and so that we can have all the participation that we, because everyone's benefits when we have full participation. So thank you very much. But with that, we're moving into executive session. So Cindy, will you take us there?
Okay, members, as a reminder, you'll see a window pop up soon asking if you'd like to join the breakout session, and just say yes or indicate that you'd like to join.
So members, also, when you get into executive session, just so that we're in compliance with our direction, I would need everyone to affirm that you are the only one in the room and no one else is there who shouldn't, of course, be there. And of course, those who are in executive session on the part of the HART staff, you'd have to identify them. So thank you. So please proceed, Cindy. Okay. Thank you very much. Members, we are back and we will be taking action on resolution number 2022-1, approving the settlement of a claim by the Associated Press. We have on the screen the actual resolution that we are being asked to vote upon. So members, may I have a motion to approve resolution number 2022-1, approving settlement of a claim by the Associated Press.
Chair, this is Anthony, I so move.
Thank you, Anthony. Any second?
Chair, second, Kika.
Thank you, Kika. Any further discussion, members? If not, I will be calling for the vote. Dan, can I just do this by unanimous? If there's no objections?
You're muted.
You're muted, Dan.
I apologize. Yes, you can, Chair.
Okay, thank you. Are there any objections? Any further comments? If not, I will assume that I have unanimous consent by all the voting members present on resolution 2022-1, and the settlement is approved. Thank you very much, members. We're now moving to item number 6, which is the status report and settlement authorization in City and County of Honolulu, acting by and through the Honolulu Authority for Rapid Transportation versus Victoria Ward Limited, civil number 18-1-1564-10-JMT. Members, I will require a motion by someone so that the board may enter into executive session pursuant to Hawaii Revised Statute Section 92-4, subsection 92A3, to deliberate concerning the authority of persons designated by the board to conduct labor negotiations or to negotiate the acquisition of public property or during the conduct of such negotiations, and subsection 92-5A4 to consult with attorneys on questions and issues on the matter pertaining to the board's powers, duties, privileges, and immunities. Can I have a motion to that effect?
Chair, so move, Kika.
Thank you, Kika. Any second?
Second, Roger.
Thank you, Roger. Is there any discussion by the members? If not, any objections? Hearing none, we are going to move into executive session. Cindy, will you please take us into executive session? Thank you very much, members of the public, for your patience. And we are back and we're moving on to agenda item number 7, resolution 2022-2 regarding the position of the board of directors of the Honolulu Authority for Rapid Transportation on transit-oriented development. By way of history, as many of you may be aware who followed HART, is that the policy positions of HART by the board, and therefore on these various items, if you followed us on the government affairs committee subcommittee meeting, there was a request that the board take positions on certain of these bills that were pending before the Hawaii State Legislature. So with that, resolution 2022-2 regarding the position of the board of directors of the Honolulu Authority for Rapid Transportation on transit-oriented development. So is Joey, who's gonna speak to this, Joey?
Yes, Chair, so this is the resolution that was drafted to support bills, including House Bill 2023, and the companion measures, Senate Bill 2154, but not limited to those two measures.
Joey, they have to be limited, with all due respect, to those.
Well, yes.
To those measures. That's what our attorney has, of course, informed us. So we are only discussing those two items. And before we begin, Joey, is SB 2154 still alive?
It is, well, it has until next week, Wednesday, to make it through, but it doesn't look like it's moving on the Senate side. It is moving, however, in the House side.
Has SB 2154 been posted?
SB, no, it has not.
Because I assume that there's, I know you have up to date for it to make basically the first cross, but isn't this also a situation of when it's posted?
Yes, no, but it hasn't even gone through the first round of committees. So it looks like it's not going to be taken up, not by the Senate anyway.
That was my impression, was that it didn't make the first one. So technically, SB 2154, I think, is not something that we should include in our resolution because it's not going to make it out anyway. But having said that, would you like to explain your resolution?
Sure, Chair.
Board vote on this. Yes. Okay, go ahead.
So, Chair, yeah. So basically, we took a resolution that... we just used a template from a position that was developed in the past that the board supported in the past. We just basically changed the be it resolves. We updated the language and then just changed the be it resolves to reflect the legislation we are planning to support this year.
For those members who were not present at the government, basically the government affairs meeting, what exactly does HB 2023?
Thank you, Chair. Yes. Okay. So the measure would authorize the issuance of a general bond obligation and appropriates funds for certain transit-oriented development projects identified in the state strategic plan for transit-oriented development. The bill was amended to remove any amounts. The proposed amount was about $2 million. That's been blanked out just as it's going through the process. But it yesterday made it out of the Finance Committee in the House without any amendments. But yes, so it's about $2 million for general obligation bonds that the House is looking to pass over to the Senate.
Wait a minute, they zeroed that out. So there is no bond amount, right? And they have a defective date of 2050?
That is correct, Chair.
So it isn't 2 million. It may have started as 2 million, but it's a zero amount now. Isn't that correct?
That is correct, Chair.
So are you saying that that this board should support that it be considered $2 million, or are you just saying that we support the HB 2023 as amended and heading for the floor for the first, being the final, the third reading on this bill?
Well, you know, the board would be supporting the original intent of the measure, which, you know, it's blanked out right now, but basically the original intent, it seems to be that there's been a series of appropriations that go towards the state strategic plan for transit-oriented development. This is just one of those appropriations. And again, you know, right now the bill in the HD1 is blanked out, but, you know, you're supporting, I would say you're supporting the original intent of the measure.
We are in agreement that SB 2154 is probably dead and therefore should be eliminated from this resolution.
Yes, Chair. Oh.
Any discussions or any questions of Joey by members of the board?
Chair.
Yes, Kika.
Joey, can you show the second page again, the be it resolved? Thanks. So, I think the first lateral, I think the deadline was the 19th. So I think that one is dead, the Senate bill. But you may want to consider, Joey, I guess, updating the HB 2023 to reflect HD1. And maybe, I don't know if you know, the as introduced. I hear what you're saying, you know, the original intent, but I guess right now we're looking at HD1. And then, you know, to the chair's earlier point regarding limiting it to the resolution, limiting it to this HB 2023 on the third be it resolved clause. I'm not sure, Chair, if you want to take a look at the verbiage, including but not limited to, and you may want to consider amending that language.
I think that, Kika, those are good points, and that I think what we're going to have to do is, if we're going to vote on this, we're going to have to move and then move the amendments and, you know, have it with the authority to kind of clean it up as we, before we pass it on. But we are going to have that this resolution amended before we vote on it. Anthony, do you have any thoughts on this?
I mean, am I muted? No, I'm not. You know, obviously, you know, as a board member, my strongest reason for supporting the HART project in the first place was for the TOD piece of it. Mm-hmm. I think it's vital. I actually think it's a bit of an untold story in the public at large that HART is already having a major impact on our development patterns on Oahu, and in that sense is already a success. And so the idea of reminding people that we see that as part of our function to encourage TOD, I think is, as a general rule, is a good thing to do. So I understand what you're saying about the needing to tidy this up, because SB 2154 clearly is not moving, but 2023 is. And so I do think we should be expressing our support for it. And I mean, you and Kika have both been members of the ledge, so you know how it works a lot better than I. And so I'm happy to take on board any recommendations you have about how to tidy this up. But in general, I think we should be supporting efforts by the ledge to encourage TOD.
I don't believe we disagree with you. We're just looking for the proper language in this resolution. Any right. other members have any thoughts on this? If not, can I have a, let's get this straight. Do we have to move for the reso, but we have to move to amend it first? What should be the proper procedure, Dan? I think we move to the reso, we have to have the reso before the body, and then we have to then move to amend it. Isn't that correct?
Let me see if Randy has thoughts. I would think you can just make a motion to approve the resolution as amended. Randy, do you have other thoughts?
I think procedurally it may be better to move and second the original and then entertain the motion to amend. I think you need to get the initial resolution in front of the board first, and then the resolution, I mean the amendment.
That's my understanding. And then we have to also know the amendments that we have proposed. So can we move for the resolution? Anthony, is that you moving?
Yeah, Chair, I'll move the, for the sake of getting this going on a formal basis, I'll move the original motion.
Okay, any second?
Second, Kika.
Kika, second. Any discussion by the members? Now I assume we're gonna have someone who's gonna propose an amendment. I think the amendment is properly at this point in time. I'm looking at our lawyers here, and then we would vote the amendment first, and then we would vote the final resolution as amended. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's my understanding. Again, I'm gonna see if Randy has any
yes.
different you want to add.
That sounds fine.
Okay, so the amendment to this resolution that if I've written it down correctly, is we will authorize our executive officer to clean up the resolution to basically eliminate any references to SB 2154 and the general language about eliminate so that we're in compliance with what we're talking about here, which is it's the pertinent legislation, including but not limited to. We're going to have to take that out so that we're very clear that what we're talking about is HB 2023. And I think the issue regarding the HB 2023 is going to be reflected with an HD1, because procedurally that's what we have before us as we submit this. And also that it would then be, we'd have to clean up the language regarding the original intent as originally proffered, because that it doesn't have the 2 million. You know, they could go up higher. I don't know, because the original one was 2 million and now it's blanked out. So, you know, we could have a higher amount of bond authorization in the end. And we want to, of course, support the higher amount. But right now, with an HD1, we are talking about a blank. And of course, we should also probably mention in here that we want it to be effective upon approval and not in the year 2050. But that's just, you know, something that we would put in to this resolution simply because that is now how the bill is amended. So we can't support HD1 because HD1 has an effective date of 2050, and we don't want that. So we have to make that exception as well. Anybody have any questions or comments? And will somebody move those
Chair.
Amendments? Yes.
Just one clarification. So to note that the reference to measures including but not limited to is in be it resolved number 2 as well as number 3.
Okay, thank you. Well, we're going to take any reference to that out. Right, Dan, that's what we need to do, right? Take out anything that's general.
OIP's concern was with the agenda, that the agenda could contemplate the board considering matters beyond just those pieces of legislation. This resolution, though, is about your delegation of authority to staff. So I think if the board is comfortable, you can just make it concise and just refer to that piece of legislation. And then if the vehicle changes and the board needs to take further action, then Joey can bring it back to the board. So I think it's fine to tighten it up, but that was why I had put the language in there, was to try to give staff flexibility if the vehicle had changed during the course of the session.
But I think given the fact that we know that that's not the intent and that's not what we're considering on this agenda, that it be expanded, that we should probably limit it.
I agree that's probably the best course here.
Okay. So may I have a motion that incorporates those amendments? I think we all understand what we need to do in the amendment.
So moved, Kika.
Any second?
Anthony here, second.
Thank you. It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion on the amendment?
Chair, this is Natalie.
It's Natalie.
Just a comment and two comments. First of all, Dan mentioned the agenda, and I just wanted to point out that the Government Affairs and Legal Matters Committee does not include audit anymore. So just a point of clarification on that. But I also wanted to mention, I think there's a feeling out there that TOD can only occur around rail stations, and TOD has been very successful in some places around bus stations as well. So I just wanted to mention that for the record. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? If not, are there any, do I hear any objections to the amendments as described? Hearing none, I will assume that we have a unanimous vote on the amendment. The amendment having passed, let us now vote on the actual motion as amended and the actual resolution as amended. Any further discussion on that? If not, do we have any objections? Hearing none, this resolution as amended is passed. Okay, the next item is number 8, which is resolution 2022-3 regarding the position of the board of directors of the Honolulu Authority for Rapid Transportation on procurement. And this is consideration and action upon the recommendation of the Committee on Government Affairs. And as Natalie put out, we were going to take out the word audit, legal matters, and proposed legislation regarding procurement, including but not limited to SB 2382 and SB 3350. Joey, would you like to address this? By the way, these are two different bills.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, Chair. So the resolution is asking the board to express concerns with two pieces of legislation pertaining to procurement that the legislature is considering this year. The first bill is Senate Bill 2383, which is looking to eliminate the Procurement Policy Board from the statutes, from the State Procurement Office, and basically it delegates their authority now to the State Procurement Officer. And the second bill that we had concerns with was Senate Bill 3350, also relating to procurement, and this measure would require that any procurement change order that increases the contract cost by more than 50% or substantially increases the scope of work to be considered a new contract for procurement purposes. So we just consolidated basically the concerns into the one resolution, and that's what we're asking the board to consider.
I noticed that in number 2, we are authorizing the executive director and CEO to submit testimony and engage in discussions with legislators or partner or pertinent legislation, and we have to do away with the including but not limited to, consistent with the overall policy set forth herein as may be adopted by the board of directors. You see that?
Yes, Chair.
So can you explain to me why we have put that in? That's not in the other ones.
Yeah, well, that was just language that was actually recommended by the Corporation Council. Certainly we can strike it, but it's just basically asking us, asking for approval to submit testimony on these two separate measures. Senate Bill 2383 and Senate Bill 3350.
As I understand it, we, the board, are not taking, we're objecting to 2383 because we believe that that's going to give less opportunity to the citizens to have a say in the government. And the second one is the 50%. Or more become being considered a second procurement. But that, of course, as you know, has been amended. And the amendment on that is that you can sort of make your case on that. Isn't that correct?
Yes, Chair, that's correct.
Now, SB 33, I think 3350 is that one that I just mentioned, and 2383, I don't know if 2383 has an SD1, but I believe SB 2033-50 has an SD1.
2383 does have an SD1. Yes, and so does 3350.
So how are we in line with the SD1s, how it's been amended? Because I think that the 3350 says that you can, even if you're 50% or more, you can kind of make your case. Is that?
Yes. So for 3350, you're correct, Chair. The chief procurement officer who's doing the procurement wishes to justify their procurement or the change order that's going to go above 50% in writing, then it seems to be that they're able to do that as an alternative to a new procurement. So that's for 3350. And then for 2383, the SD1 is basically just conforming amendments so that it is in line with the Hawaii revised statutes, is my understanding.
Anthony, as the chair of the Government Affairs Subcommittee, do you have any thoughts on these?
Yeah, well, I think the amendment in the SD1, sorry, I'm talking here about SB 3350. I haven't talked to HARP management to ascertain whether that amendment in the SD1 changes their opinion of the bill. But just so everybody's clear, what the bill basically is saying is if a change order adds more than 50% to the cost, then it's got to be considered a new contract, except, and here's the amendment, that the head of the purchasing agency may approve a change order that is otherwise prohibited by this subsection if, in a written justification of the approval, the head of the purchasing agency determines that the approval is in the best interest of the state. So that to me looks like an escape clause. So it seems to me that in this version, the bill is not as much of a concern to us as it was until now. Is that how you see it, Joey?
Yes, board member, that is how I see it.
I'm sorry to respectfully disagree, but I still think it's a problem. That's just me. And so I just believe that we should clean up the SD1s added to it and take out including but not limited to those two, and then just go with the resolution as proposed. And they both include, as Kika pointed out in the other one, including but not limited to, because we can only discuss what's before us on the agenda, and these are the two bills that are before us. So
actually,
yes, go
ahead. I didn't feel the need to comment on that aspect of it. I thought that was taken as a given that we're all agreed that we have to take out languages that says including but not limited to, and I'm happy to offer an amendment to speed things along to that effect. But I'm not sure that we first need a resolution to actually consider the bill, and then a resolution to amend it if we're following the previous procedure, right?
Chair, this is Natalie.
Yes, Natalie.
Just a question. I know last year's bills rolled over until this year. So is it correct that these bills that we're discussing now will end at the end of this legislative session if they don't get passed? Is that correct?
That is correct.
Thank you.
Any other discussions? If not, may I first have a motion to approve resolution 2022-3. This is, of course, regarding the position of the Board of Directors of the Honolulu Authority for Rapid Transportation on procurement. And there are the two bills that we just discussed. I have that.
Chair, this is Anthony. I move.
Okay, second?
Second, Kika.
Kika seconds. Any discussion? Members, this is where I'm going to need a friendly amendment to this, which basically adds the SD1s to both of these and takes out the including but not limited to language in both of the 1 and 2 and SD1s on both of that. Can I have a motion?
Pauline, Chair, this is Anthony. I so move.
Second, Kika. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you, Kika. So it's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion on this, members? If not, hearing none, are there any oppositions? If not, I'm going to rule that we have unanimous consent on these amendments. We have unanimous consent. Now, of course, we're going to move, members, we are going to vote on the resolution 2022-3 as amended. Any further discussion? If not, any opposition?
Nope.
If not, is there an opposition? If not, members, I'm going to deem that we have a unanimous consent and resolution 2022-3 as amended. And of course, like the prior one, we're leaving it up to our executive officer to do these cleaning up before we send it in. Members, we're now moving to item number 9, resolution 2022-4, regarding the position of the Board of Directors on the Honolulu Authority for Rapid Transportation on board retreats. Joey, do you want to withdraw? You want the board to consider withdrawal? Because I believe both of these have been deferred or are no longer viable. Is that correct?
Yes, Chair. Yesterday, the House bill was deferred. You still have some time on the Senate bill, but it doesn't look like it's moving.
Doesn't the Senate bill, did it pass lateral?
It only has one referral.
Oh, this is a judiciary only referral?
Yes, Chair.
But we have no indication that this has been actually scheduled?
Yes, no, it hasn't been scheduled.
Okay, so given that, Anthony, are you okay with us basically not considering this at this time, because it looks like it's not going to move?
Yeah, I haven't talked to the chair in the Senate to see if this is moving forward. I mean, obviously, it's something I think we all support, the idea of being able to have an annual retreat. So I'm not sure, Joey, have you had a chance to talk? I guess that would be Senator Lee's committee, would it?
This would be wrong, yeah. Isn't it?
It would have been
right.
So it would be in judiciary. I'm not sure who the chair is at right now. I believe it is Senator Lee. I believe it is Senator Rhodes. I'm sorry, but
have
yes.
I mean, do we know if they're intending to, if Senator Rhodes is intending to move it forward? I mean, is it worth having this a resolution from us in your back pocket in case it does move forward?
You know, they have to schedule it by next week. It has to emerge from committee by Thursday next week, if I'm not mistaken. It's certainly possible.
I think that what we can do is that if it does make it out of committee, it doesn't look like it, but if it does, then it still has to go to the House, and at that time we can reintroduce or reconsider this resolution as it makes its way through the House, and we'll know. But I think right now, given the fact that we know the House bill has been deferred, chances are even if they were to make it out, it may also be deferred. But in any event, it's not that we don't have any other bites of the apple, so to speak. We do have the opportunity, if it makes it out and it crosses over, that we'll be able to do that. Do you agree, Joey?
Chair, you make a very good point. Yes, I agree.
So with that, can I, members, I'm going to defer this matter on the agenda, because it also appears that it's not going to move forward, but I guess subject to the fact that we can always re-agendize it if it becomes relevant. Any other comments or questions? Dan, you have that look on your face. Do you have anything to say?
I don't, Chair. Thank you.
Okay, members, we're going to move to the last item on the agenda, which is the Interim Executive Director and CEO's quarterly and annual performance review. I would require a motion to go into executive session.
Chair, this is Anthony. I so move. Yes.
Okay. Let me read it out, just because we have to have it on the record. Pursuant to Hawaii's revised statute 92-4, and subsection 92-5A2, to consider the hire, evaluation, dismissal, and discipline of an officer, employee, or of charges brought against the officer or employee where consideration of matters affecting privacy will be involved, and subsection 92-5A4 to consult with its attorneys on questions and issues of matters pertaining to the board's powers, duties, privileges, immunities, and liabilities. And thank you, Anthony, for moving. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, thank you, Roger. It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? If not, I will deem it to be a unanimous vote. And Cindy, take us into executive session, please. Okay. Thank you very much to the members of the project public. We are back in session. I'm here to announce the fact that item number 10, which is the Interim Executive Director and CEO's quarterly and annual performance review, we are deferring that matter because Lynn McCrory, who is the Chair of Human Resources, is not here. And we believe that her input is essential for that. So we will be re-noting it on the agenda in the near future, as soon as we are able to confirm when Lynn will be here. So with that, members, we are actually at the end of, by the way, I hear no objections to my deferral, so I'm gonna assume that we're unanimous in it. And we are at item number 11, which would be the adjournment. But however, before we go there, we'll take some liberty here to inform the public who have seen Randy Ishikawa as part of our crew, that Randy will be retiring, becoming a grandpa as of February 28th. So you will not see him. We do know that he has a very competent successor in Dan Gluck. However, there may be members of the board who have, who may wish to say their goodbyes to Randy. And of course, you know, we know that he can't stay away. So we expect him to be grandpa for maybe a month, and then I'm sure he'll get bored. Chasing a three-year-old around the room isn't going to be fun. And he'll be back in some capacity. He's saying no, but we all think he will be. But in any event, members, anybody would like to say their goodbyes to Randy? I'm sure Randy is going to be very happy not to hear my voice, but other than that, he may really want to hear from all of you. Anyone? Anybody wants to say goodbye?
Chair, this is Anthony.
Anthony?
I'm not quite the newest member of the board. Mark joined shortly after I did, so I was unfortunately didn't have as much interaction with Randy as the rest of the members of the board. But you know, everyone I had was wonderful, not just because of the quality of the advice, obviously, but because of the quality of Randy and what he brought to it. And you know, friendly and helpful in every way. So I for one will miss him, and thanks for the opportunity to wish him aloha.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to?
Yeah.
Yes, Kika.
Yeah, I just want to say thanks to Randy, and I think I mentioned it to him before that I appreciate his honesty and you know, most of all the way he approaches things. You know, we have agreed on some things and we haven't on others, and you know, regardless, you know, he's always approached it from a very in a very good way that I appreciate, and I hope to take some lessons from him on how to do that. But I hope to see him, you know, either professionally or personally in the future, and wish him well.
Yeah, and this is Roger, Randy, and I too share and join everybody else's comment. I know the times that we have had the discussions, I always appreciate the friendly and frank and yet very professional advice and counsel that you always provide to me personally, and I know to all the rest of the board members as well. And I too join everybody in wishing you a very happy retirement. I wish I had grandkids. I'm gonna, maybe I wouldn't be here if I did, but so I totally understand your priorities in life, and I wish you well.
This is Mark. I wanna wish you well. I just had my first grandson after three granddaughters, and my daughter, Oliva Joes, passes out cookies and said, you've been promoted to grandpa. And the next thing out of her mouth is we're moving to Virginia.
Oh.
So she sold her house in Sea Country in 5 days, which was amazing. And so I'm going to enjoy being having a grandson. So good luck.
Thank you, Mark. Anyone else?
Yeah, Chair, Jade, thank you, Randy, as well for allowing Hart to be part of your career. You take your role seriously by protecting Hart and made it better. Best wishes in your next endeavor, and have you, you know, hope you have a healthy and happy retirement.
Thank you.
Hey, Randy, this is Dean. Echo what everybody else says. Your professionalism on the board is really appreciated. And when you do get bored of being a grandpa, come. I got some hearings officer work I can hire you for. So anytime you want some extra cash, let me know. I'll bring you on immediately. Good luck.
Is it for TV use?
It might be.
See, Randy, you're lucky. I'm still looking out for you. Trying to make sure they don't put you into a black hole somewhere. Anyone else?
Yeah, Chair, this is Natalie.
Yes, Natalie.
Yeah, so congratulations, Randy. You know, a three-year-old grandchild is just very, very exciting. And it's good to know that people put family first. And thank you so much for keeping us up on the straight and narrow on all the stuff that has come forth before this board. Thank you again and congratulations.
Thank you, Natalie. Anyone else? If not, members,
I'd like to respond. And
oh, if you don't mind.
I'd really like to thank, you know, I've worked with this project for 6 years plus, and with a very, you know, with this board, this current board, as well as all the prior boards over that time period. And uniformly, I'd like to state my appreciation for all of the work that the board and all of the prior boards have done on this project. And, you know, give my appreciation for all of you and all of that you have done. It does take, you know, the strong leadership on the board, as well as within Hart, and really for all the people who work at Hart and for Hart. That's what it's going to take to have this project succeed. And I trust that it's in good hands. Dan will be great. And I'm sure that, you know, I will be a forgotten issue after a while, and leave you in good hands there. And also like to state my appreciation for all of the, you know, professionalism that you've shown towards me. I agree. There's sometimes where we are not in agreement on things, but appreciate the respect that was given. And thank you again for all of your help and support and hard work on this project, on this very worthwhile project. Thank you again.
Thank you, Randy. So hearing no other voices out there.
Sorry, Chair. May I suggest that you make one last call for public testimony? Yeah, thank you.
Okay. So is there anyone who missed the beginning and would like to present testimony on any of the agenda items? And my understanding is people may have had difficulty getting on the WebEx, and I assume that if you want to make testimony that you're with us now. Is there anyone?
I don't see anyone logged on, Chair.
Thank you. And again, we will make sure that it's stated clearly in the next agenda and the directions from the board that you do not have to sign in. And we will be sure to indicate what the login procedure is. And, you know, you can always present testimony, because that is what we're interested in, is the testimony that members of the public may have. So with that, anyone else? If not, thank you very much, members, and we are adjourned. I'm hearing no objections to adjournment, so we will be adjourned. Thank you very much.